Dís maríomh agus tá fáilte roiibh go dtín badchréile seo de chud GAA Gold na scéalta ina méadna a plé cuasaí pelle agus amána ón bblion 1982. Líon ina bhuaigh í fáilí cluiche canis cáúil pelle in ag chiaí, bhuaigh ceilchunig ar chorcaigh i gluiche canis na hamána agus bhí golóir eile a tharla ar agus den bhorc freisin. Tá trúr í le cuasaí den bblion sin a phléilem an sotránóna in jobh. Ar dúspóire, captain í fáilí ón gluiche cáúil sin in ag chiaí, Richie Connor. Díochuid, Richie.
Is ar a gcuir a fhéil chud is tátil?
Anna bhar fáil go rila magad. Chomá tá fear chail chuinnig an fear a bhí a gimirt mar lántasí an lá úd thá chúil agus trí chúlaí naimsethe ag Christy Heffernan sa chluiche canis. Díochuid, Christy.
Ai chomá, ní hall.
Agus chomá tá an tíris ar sport atá lonathe i Bort Láirige, Mactara Macdonacha Ling. Hello, Mactara.
Hello, Mike. Tás a chomá.
Anna bhar fáil go magad. Mac, fanna mí dlaat sa ar dúspóire. Bhí blian má sport a gwing o heim na pelle agus amána. A cad a bhí atá luint taobh amod de héil an sport?
Ba stó hea an príomh scéal sa tír seo bhí rá oldthóch an bhlíon chéine. Cean amháin a féilras, cean amháin a mín is aonas. Ní hárlas an hórháin riamh eile ó bunú an stáit. Hárlas an idir fix a seacht. Agus bhí scoibhil an grab fóthóchán i mo gháil cheantar héin gaile thir agus bhí sé na sprí, bhí siúchan an orga ag an am. Bina cén rud, is an dar rud bhí an na hiláin Malvina Argentín bhí coga idir an Argentín agus Sasana agus an bratan istóchí seach a Sasana agus an chinbéidir an tríúcán fear go bhunú na héirin Michael Fagan tannin bhí ar Jerry leis stach a fada leis omar cuntat na banrína a Buckingham Palace.
Ó, agus na bhrálaat an córá sin a bheith cluiste go sin scéal thairis. OK, gur mágad a bhachtara. Tásóm idir ríis mar sin le cuasaí amána. An Christy, just from the Kilkenny perspective, I suppose you'd had the previous year Offaly winning their first All-Ireland in hurling. You had Galway winning in 1980. So I suppose there must have been a fair bit of soul-searching done in Kilkenny to get back on top heading into that campaign, was there?
There was, yeah. Well, we had a lot of experience on the team, really. But, you know, it was felt that there was probably new players needed. But there was quite a few that I played minor with that were on that team. Richie Power, John Henderson, Dick O'Hara, Paddy Pendergast, Liam Fenley. He was a year after us. But, you know, but still we had a lot of experience from, you know, like Sir Frank Cummins, John Henderson, Noel Skeen, Brian Cody was the captain. And Gerard Fenley was captain in 79. So there was a lot of experience for the big day out. But a lot of us were rookies, though, on the day. And, you know, we just took our chances when they came our way.
And what about the league campaign that year? Because you won the league that year. And I know
it was extraordinary kind of a league because we were actually playing Division 1B. And that particular year, we went down to Kerry. And we played Kerry and Tralee in the National League. And we drew with Kerry. We didn't beat him, we drew with him. Now, we went down the night before.
That's the danger sometimes.
That was the danger, yeah. But still, yeah. You know, not taken away, that was the team we fought our way back. We won that division, went on the whole way to win the National League. And it gave us, we all got confidence in that. And, you know, tougher games going on from there. We had rights from the league final, but, you know, the league really stood to us.
And then on into the championship, because in Gleich Canish and Huiga Ganaris Diary Glechal Huinig and Love and Uhtera Oil, Eri Foley, Kurha Ila Aaron on Flea and Ryson, Rivgar Hasader, Haile Vigleha La Canish Naharan, Agassi Anna Law in the Crit.
And early stalemate there before the ball is eventually hit out over the sideline this side of the field. Ball grabbed in there again, and oh, it's over the bar. Christy Heffernan, the scorer. It looked for a moment as if it was going into the top left-hand corner of the goal. He then decided he'd go back in. He made up about 10 of them, but then he made up for it all by sending the ball over the bar. And the puck out, hopping way downfield, and Christy Heffernan in contention there, and the ball goes into Liam Fenley. It's a goal! Liam Fenley, the goal getter. The far side, Tom McCormack. And waiting for him is Kieran Brennan. Ball deflected in towards the goal. It is! It's a goal! It's a goal for Kilkenny. a ball that went lobbing in there, waiting for somebody to finish it, and it was Richie Powell who finished it. And it just won't come up for them. Look at Paddy Prendergast, he's everywhere today. Liam Fennelly, what a lovely artistic shot. Christy Heffernan, across to the waiting Ger Fennelly. Ger takes a shot, and Ger sends it over the bar for another point for Kilkenny. This will be the last puck of the first half. Or will it? Not quite. Here it comes now. This is Michael Connolly going through. Still Michael Connolly. A goal! That is the last puck of the first half. Oh, what a great goal by Michael Connolly. He may have broken his hurley. PJ Malloy standing way back, as you can see. He's going to run up. Here it comes. A goal! That's what had to come. PJ Malloy crashing it into the back of the net. Lovely puck out by Noel Skeehan. Sean Silk is in there. Kieran Brennan has the ball, he's going right through now. He's hooked by Iggy. He's still going through, he hand passes it over the bar for another point for Kilkenny. Kieran Brennan the scorer. Kilkenny and Cork in the All-Ireland final. Referee is looking for the ball and the game is over. The game is over. Kilkenny, 2 goals and 20 points. Galway, 2 goals and 10.
So Christy, that must have really set you up. I mean, to beat a team who'd been in the All-Ireland final the previous year and then having beaten the previous All-Ireland champions, Offaly, in the Leinster final, and to win against Galway so comfortably, how did that feel in terms of self-confidence ahead of the final then?
Well, I was pretty nervous right now because my first big games with Kilkenny, I didn't make the first 15 for the Leinster final. They came on as a sub, okay, but, it was... I suppose having the lads around me was a great help. You know, the experienced lads around me, and they gave me great confidence. Thanks to the Fendi brothers and Frank Cummins, the Hendersons. You know, it was they had experienced that before. It was new to me, new to Richie Power, Kieran Brennan. It was new to a few of us. So, Galway, that was a fantastic Galway team. You know, they didn't. We were probably hungrier. You know, Galway had to, maybe they might have been caught the previous year, but definitely it was a strong Galway team, and they proved it in the one afterwards. The same, like, see Conor Hayes there playing, like he was only young for then, you know.
Absolutely. Okay, well, sure, look at Kilkenny through to the final. So in Aghaidhcurcaig, Maradort Mihal O'Hare and son. So Aharom Eden on Focus and Ishka Pell. So obviously Richie, Kerry were the team. They had the four in a row won. Ye had been the team that had come probably closest to them over those 4 years. Ye had been beaten by them in the All-Ireland final in 81, in the All-Ireland semi-final in 1980. Was there a feeling around the county that it had to be 82, or maybe things might drift away from this team?
From the start of the year, I think we would have been talking about Kerry, which is it was a different scenario to the previous years. Like in 1980, we set out to win a Leinster. You know, that was the complete focus. There was no mention of Kerry in 81 then when we got to the All-Ireland final. Like it was nearly a matter of containment. that there wasn't that a great air of confidence, to be quite honest. But from the start of 82, Kerry was being talked about from day one, really. You know, that we have to be able to match Kerry, we have to be able to do this, we have to be able to do that. So there was a different focus completely. And we nearly paid a price for it. We were very lucky to get out of Mullingar against Westmead in the first round. We only won by a pint or two. Could have easily been beaten. And I'd say it was for that reason, the whole programme that Eugene McGee had laid out, we were doing more geared towards a long-term campaign, you know, and very nearly paid a high price.
Magdara, O'Dohev should have fechant Aaron Vlianson, I guess. Bader v. Dactric de Curie, Margarevan Lucht Lanta. near Evan Cooig as the Kayla Burte again there in Hanahane. So, the Loch Lantis ice Marhunstack a point or again, Vurin Hane. Kagresha Dakarig Miko Dryer, the Achamad Bugani Q in the Dalishtak treating about the egg Sula.
Provision Dakarig is Mars Oldoon and Group of Kyolch and Galleon, Nilen Hall or Wonger Hugadermach on Toron Kolul, five in a row, because Vishashin Mar Inspired Evoli, I was being a tea lane or deal carry 5 in a row, Achan Farvi, Visha Glick, Pusha X 3 on 5 in a row, Yilcha Eid Galer, who's an Evoli in the Yershin. So, Jairo go Malish and Chin. Ach, yeah, we got in a cap of Gura. Kegura Evoli attacked, like such a special fechant Nidrik Shachto Hocht, Jim Revoli and I Balaklia. Shin and log of Rish on Kula on goalpost. Richie, it was.
Yeah, Visha Gibbard, Manu Ayan again.
Yeah, Honig Shastach is Hobbach of Lachlia. Bin Shakta Hocht, Cliff Lakanish Lion. Neither Shakta Ni, Huchit Kavala, Cliff Kanish Lion. Kuruji McKeeve, Nidan Bark and Vlinchen, Bakarta Vibuti Givoli. Neither Gokto, Vushit Cliff Kanish Lion. Neither Gokto Hain, Vushit Cliff Lakanish the Hair. So we came one Hunkin Gaplin, Ahogal, Egivoli. Rudnar Higmuj Vedra Ganam, Tigmuj Nisha.
Jack and thou Kiri Fos about Riha Napella Egabuintisha, Keravua Asichela, Adoldon Kugu Krev Asichela, Ila Aaron at Rivishin, Ganaris Vehar Hakliha Lachanish, Nahir and the Vokant, Agasuga the Shud, Aig Ard Vacha, Agashoga Vinish the Book Fainty.
All set now for the start of the game, the band leaving the field. And dead on the 3:30, the game is on. And Armagh first to get it. Colin McKinstry, Paddy Moriarty. John Corbin trying to get into it. He's got to it. And a save there by Charlie Nettigan. Gerard O'Keefe tearing the ball down. Got here by Noel Marley. Brian Hughes. Joe Kernan. Back to Fran McMahon. And Fran is over the score after 50 seconds of play. And Cody O'Shea to take the kick. John Egan, Ger Power, on the bomber, and it's over the bar. Owen Liston, another Kerry passing movement, and Owen Liston, the man who finished it, Paddy Moriarty. Joe Kernan, and a point, a lovely point there by Joe Kernan. Tom Scallon, who hasn't been so much in the game up to now, but here he is. Mikey Sheehy, Jack O'Shea, Mikey Sheehy, and it is a goal. A goal, a lovely passing movement there with Jack O'Shea, Corbin, and after him is Cody Lynch. Comes to Peter Rafferty. Rafferty back now to Corbin, trying to get through. He's in front of the goal. Joe Kernan. It's a goal! And breaking for the ball now is Ogie Morden. Ogie to John Egan. Oh! A goal! John Egan, the scorer. Jack O'Shea, and Jim McCarr lets it go by. Owen Liston trying to get back with him. John Egan with the ball. Gerard Power, John Egan. Owen Liston, and a goal! Oh, what a goal! To the final whistle, and there it is.
To be quite honest with you, we were very, very worried. Very, very worried at halftime. We were only, was it 5 or 6 points up, and Armagh were playing very, very well. We didn't play very well in the first 15 minutes. We settled down a little bit better then, but we got a couple of goals just after the start of the second half, and that settled us down and eased our problems.
There's a disturb you and your colleagues that everybody's talking about. Nobody can stop Kerry now. It does, to a certain extent, because as everybody knows or should know, no team is unbeatable. And we take every match very, very seriously. And I think if you go by the general opinion in Kerry alone, I mean, 200 supporters didn't travel up to this game. It's a bit worrying at times that it could get to the players.
Yeah, I suppose defending the players and keeping the players away from all that hype for Mick O'Dwyer, Richie, must have been manna from heaven for you in Offaly. Of course, he still had to play Galway, and we'll take a look at that match in a second. But just general points, I mean, the pressure was all on Kerry. I mean, you were really flying in, even though you had the pedigree. You must have felt that the pressure was all on one side and that you were at a shot to nothing, really.
Oh, absolutely. And so it was. And I think Eugene McGee would have talked about it a bit, you know, that the more that Kerry's hyped up, the better it is for us. That fell into our laps, you know, and the song and all that sort of thing helped as well. That semi-final was a week before ours, so the game that I think we're going to look at now, the semi-final, was a very poor game. Our game against Galway, it was a very, very windy day, blustery day, and the quality of football was very poor, and so everything sort of fell into our laps, really.
All right, well, we'll take a look at that. So, if Ali Agus Gaelef Cleha Anna Yown, La Gaifer Abark and Hrokig, Le Fechen K. Avech, Le Kiri, Sechle Hekanish.
Pisted further up through the centre there by Jerry Carroll. But Brian Talty nipping in. This is Gay McManus and coming to help him there on the far side and going up the field with Barry Brennan. Barry Brennan up now to Tom Nocton. Nocton in front of the goal. It's a goal! It's a goal for Galway! Intercepted there by Tomás Tierney. Tom Nocton back now to Brian Talty. Talty, a nice high ball, and it's gone over the bar. A lovely point by Brian Talty, and the Galway men picking off the scores from out the field, as they've done so often. Johnny Mooney coming down for it. Cross into the centre now, and this is Brendan Lowry. Goal! Goal by Brendan Lowry. And the kick taken by Tomás Tierney. And that's the other Tomás now, Connor. And that's the wonderful feeling of Pádraig Dunne. Into the centre now to Jerry Carroll. Still Jerry Carroll. A left-footed shot that's gone over the bar, and now there's only one point between them. Jerry Carroll not so much in the game as he had been against Dublin. Richie Connor. And Johnny Mooney with the ball. Dynan. And the kick half blocked down there. This is Brendan Lowry. And there is the lead for Offaly. Brendan Lowry getting the ball there. And Donald on top of the left. Switches all round the place here now. Offaly 1-11, Galway 1-10. Offaly in the attack again. Richie Connor. It's high and it's over the bar for a point. Richie from out on the far sideline, sending that one over. And Richie a little bit disappointed, I think, that some of his play hadn't been as good as he had expected. Passed in now to Gay McManus. And Gay on his way through with a shot that's high. It's gone to the left and it's gone wide. And Gay is absolutely disgusted. It is Offaly by 1 point. Offaly 112, Galway 111. One solitary point.
Yeah, Richie, your point there was, I think it came 8 minutes from time. It ended up being the winning point, indeed. 112 to 111, as Niall O'Hare has said there. But as he said himself, plenty of room for improvement in Offaly still.
Plenty of room for improvement. And Galway had plenty of chances after that. Like, I think they missed a couple of frees and stuff. But I was lucky enough to get on the team that day because I had missed the Leinster final, but I got a cartilage operation. And Sean Lowry had played, I played centre-back earlier on the year, and Sean Lowry played centre-back in Leicester final. Offaly had an easy win over Dublin. And I was very lucky to get a place in the team at all. And so...
And that was a thing I wanted to ask you about. So Sean Lowry had obviously, he'd experience of playing in the forwards up until
Sean
that
had
point.
Played full forward earlier on the year. And yeah. then in the Leicester final, he you know, I was missing. I've been playing centre-back. And so he played centre-back in the Leicester final and had a very good game. And, you know, so...
that was a master switch in the wind-up, wasn't it?
Sorry?
You know, that was a master switch considering Sean's role as well in the final, you know, as an extra ballast, like, say, for those Kerry attacks. It was a great move putting him back there, wasn't it?
That was, yeah. Well, Sean was always a great stalwart, you know, very versatile. He went on to win a Connacht Championship with Mayo at full forward, you know, so he was just one of those players that could... He played cornerback in... when he came onto the team first, you know, so he's just a complete all-rounder.
And I believe we heard the story last week of Sean that after he'd lost the final the previous year, he went to Kerry, didn't he? He went to Kerry when the Kerry team came home and he got...
Oh, he was down, yeah.
Go on, tell us that story. He said that this cup will be back in Offaly next year. Didn't he say something like that?
Yeah, well, Sean didn't say much in the dressing room, but what he said was always very positive and very to the point. You know, he was a great character.
Great character.
One of the big features of the Offaly thing was that for the All-Ireland Final in 82, I think it was the first time that I can recall that we had everybody, or Eugene McGee or the selectors, had everybody at their disposal. We were missing nobody at all. In the 81 final, both Johnny Mooney and Tomás Connor, well, Tomás started, but he was carrying an injury. He probably shouldn't have started. You know, he's like, if there was real fitness tests, I think he probably wouldn't have passed it. And Johnny Mooney had fell off a load of turf, bringing home turf, and damaged his shoulder. So, for a county like Offaly, we couldn't afford to be missing anybody, like especially high-quality players like Tomás and Johnny Mooney. And other games, there was always somebody missing with an ankle or a knee or something like that. And, you know, the likes of Kerry, they had, you know, more resources, bigger panels and so on and so forth. But we were more hit with serious injuries like that. But for the A2 final, we had absolutely no injury. It was just everybody was available, you know, which was a huge, huge thing.
And you had the secret weapon on the bench ready to come on and score a goal with a few minutes to go as well. And we'll talk about Seamus Darby in a little while when we get to look at that match. Coming into the final then, Christy, in the hurling then. And before we look at the highlights, I want to ask you about Brian Cody. Now, I want to show you a clip first of Brian Cody. This is a clip from the programme Hands, a famous RTE programme back in the 80s. As Brian visits Raimi Dowling of Star Hurleys, picking up his hurls for the All-Ireland final. So take a look at this first.
Brian Cody is another of today's young Lions. He's Kilkenny's captain. His team are about to play Cork in the All-Ireland final. The prize is hurling's Holy Grail.
Hello, friend Raimi. Nice. Grain looks very good in that,
eh? Yeah, we've got a bit of two. We're a very good bit of two.
Definitely. Ah, yeah, this is one of really fancy, all right.
Here's the bands and do them up.
Now, that's a grand job altogether.
Well, as long as they're lucky.
Exactly. Stuff matters.
How about that one then?
No, Brian. Another one.
Save.
It'll never make me mind up. Huh? But that's a grand hurler, isn't it? It is. It feels very like the other one, this one here.
Yeah.
A very similar type of hurls. Great grain in it again. And
grand.
I like the hand, I like the grip. Yes. I suppose I better make up my mind anyway, Raimi.
Yes, right now. Well, that's up to you.
Suppose I took these two, how would that
be? Yeah, that'll do grand, Brian.
That's grand.
As long as they're lucky, that's the main thing.
Hopefully they're two grand sticks.
So, Christy, I don't know if you've seen that clip before, but that must bring you back.
So Raimi was a pure gentleman from Kilmacow in South Kilkenny, but he was great. Everything detailed on every hurley And you see Brian there when he was holding the hurley, you know, the feel just kind of waving in his hands. We all do that for some reason. And, you know, I think if you have that feel and, you know, every hurley is different. Every player has a different feel for hurley. You know, the taller, the smaller. But yeah, one thing noticeable there on them, you probably see it in recent times, the boss on the hurley is huge now compared to what we had then. But there was far more striking at the ground hurling then. You see, the shape of the hurley was different. The ball was hitting the ground because, you know, if you were raising the ball going to a tackle that time, you'd only go into the tackle once. You wouldn't be going again. Whereas now you can go in and get free every time. You know, there's different interpretations of rules now than back then. But no, Ramey was, he was a lovely man, you know.
And what about Brian then? Because obviously we know all about him as an inter-county manager, the most successful county manager of all time. But as a player and as a captain, what was he like in the dressing room?
No, Pat Henderson was the boss. But we all did what we were told and did the best we could.
So Pat was manager, but Brian's role, I mean, as captain, did he speak?
No, he didn't have to speak. No, the captain never spoke in our time. It was just down to the manager and the selectors. And, you know, if things weren't going well, you'd see somebody warming up on the sideline. You know, the curly finger would come out for you then. But, you know, no, everybody, you knew what they had to do and played for each other. We all, didn't matter who scored, once we got more scores than the opposition at the end of the day. And, you know, the best line of defence was our corner forward.
Okay, and what about Brian as a player then? Because you would have marked him, obviously, all the time in training.
I would have marked him. Yeah, I would have marked him pretty often in training, okay. And I was from South Kilkenny. We had a strong football area in South Kilkenny, Glenmore. James Stevens, if you're north of Ballyhale, you were south of Ballyhale, that's where all the hurlers were, south of Ballyhale, Glenmore, Pilton, Mullabat. You know, we were classed as, second class. I wouldn't say that maybe now, but... We seldom got a look in, but Mark and Brian in training now, I certainly learned a lot from him, and over time, I probably developed my game better, having the experience. He had tricks, and I got used to the tricks, so I was able to handle them as time went on. But then North and Kenny fellas were a class of their own.
I'm sure they were. And Brian, of course, had played briefly as a full forward himself, hadn't he? And was it the 78 final?
That's
and
right.
Things didn't go well for him that day.
No, that's right. It's unusual. Like, for a man that was so successful, he was one of the best underage hurlers that Kilkenny had seen for years. You know, played minor under 21, and he was an all-star, I think, in 1974. But Brian really put everything into his game. You know, he his finer points, he always made sure they were right. He was always well prepared. Not like me, I was usually late for the match, but Brian was, I suppose he set example back then. We probably didn't notice it because, you know, we were focused on our game and focused on Pat Henderson, what he was saying, and the selectors. But, over time, I suppose, Brian, he developed certainly as a manager. My God, I couldn't believe it, like how successful they are. And he's still there and after having a bypass and all that. But, you know, he has the hunger for it. Captain's role back then was, you know, you go up and get the trophy and say your bit. There was nothing special about it at that time, you know.
Right. Le Calchunny Coyle had the Chlech Canish Naharan, Trish and Love and Ofter Oil, in some out of Lachanish Anish, beg the book find to you going. Calchunny, August Kirkig, August Law Harlehanta, the Vintra Calchunny.
They've been gathering here since early this morning because there's something about this clash of Cork and of Kilkenny that adds a kind of glamour to even a glamorous occasion like an All-Ireland final. And the game is on. Cork the first to get into attack, and this is Ray Cummins. Ray Cummins high and over the bar. After 10 seconds of play, no Kilkenny man touched that ball. Ray Cummins opens the score with Cork 1 point, Kilkenny no score. Jimmy Barry, Ray Cummins, Jimmy Barry, up to the windy shot in Erie, and that's blocked by Noel Skeehan the first time, and they're in there on top of them. And out comes Kilkenny with the ball. Out comes Paddy Prendergast with the ball. Oh, lovely bit of feeling there by Ger Henderson. Dermot McCurtain has lost the hurdling out to Tim Crowley. It's one across. Ray Cummins with it now. Ray trying for a point and Ray getting a point. And Billy Fitzpatrick. John Blake. Frank Cummins. I was going to say all alone, but not for long. A goal! A goal! Frank Cummins gets it in, and it was deflected. And it was deflected by Christy Heffernan. And now we're back alive, and it's Christy Heffernan again. He's going through. He's getting ready to take a shot. And it is a goal. A goal by Christy Heffernan. And Kilkenny have run them up. Heffernan, two goals in a matter of a minute.
Well, I'm sure Noel is very satisfied with that absolute touch of brilliance that we saw a moment ago.
That was short passing there, Liam Fennelly. A dangerous ball. Ger Fennelly. A goal! A goal by Ger Fennelly. The icing in the Kilkenny cake as Ger Fennelly took that one and there isn't a man alive. In towards Jimmy Barry. Bertie Oak, who's been hopped off there like a yo-yo. Nice and fairly, let me add. And here's Eamon O'Donoghue trying to get through. He's working his way through. He's almost in court, but he's got the ball in and the referee signals it's a goal. There is a crowd rushing. They are into hog piss and what have you, go skiing. But Noel would very much like to put the ball out. Jim Tracy in there, a former star, if I'm not mistaken. Referee looking up, but now he had an apple, but he doesn't have a hurling ball. And there goes the final whistle, and Kilkenny are the All-Ireland champions. The final score, Kilkenny, 3 goals and 18 points. Cork, 1 goal and 13, 27 points to 16.
Great memories, Christy, I'm sure.
Great memories, yeah.
The two goals you got, I mean, in a couple of minutes just before halftime, effectively sealed the deal, I think, that day, didn't it?
Yeah, we were going reasonably well at the time. We got a few scores before that, and the Cork forwards were getting frustrated. The Kilkenny defence, it was kind of, the weather conditions weren't great that day. A bit, you know, overcast and mist wet. But, you know, the defence held very tight. There was great workmanship back and forward. And, of course, Cork came into the game, you know, having coasted through Waterford in the Munster final. Now, that Waterford team had played us in the semi-final of the National League, and we only drew with them. So there was nothing between the teams. But we felt that, you know, the Cork were... We had nothing to lose. Martin Doherty was up here about 16 or 17 Ireland medal. And, you know, I remember the night before that match. I was watching the television up for the match at home. And there was the Cork lads, of course, travelled the night before, and there were some interviews on it. And I can't remember who was doing the TV that time. But anyway, they asked Martin Doherty the question, was how many Ireland medals had he had? And he had about 15 or 16 between underage and every damn thing. I said, you won't have fucking one tomorrow. But, you know, it gave us a great incentive to get stuck in for it, you know.
The one thing when you said that, the thing that most amazes me is that Martin Donoghue, the Cork fullback, was allowed on the television the night before the final.
Oh, Martin O'Doherty, yeah.
That
was the way it was, up for the match. What's the name used to do it? Liam O'Murahu, was it?
Oh, Liam O'Murahu, yes.
Yeah, he'd been a mad Cork man. It was only he saw the one colour, you know.
Yeah.
But it was good for us that, pardon?
Cork were fancying their chances then for that final.
Oh, they were. Like, they had a fantastic Munster Championship, you know. They won the Munster Championship so easy, and they were after having 3 in a row. You see, most of the team from the three in a row were there. They're all there, and you know, they had great success with that team. And the dog on the street could pick the team, but you know, we had a lot of newcomers and a few lads that they might have probably might have felt that some of our lads were a bit stale as well. But you know, I think on the day, you know, we took our chance as well. There was a great workmanship all over the field, from you know the last the 25th man to the first man. There was a great camaraderie with the team as well, and you know, everybody fought for each other. Out
of your four, you won four in 81, 82, and then 91, 92, just at the tail end of your career. Was that your best day in the Kilkenny shirt, that one?
92-3. I suppose it happens. To be honest, it happened so quick. The game went so quick, I couldn't believe it was over. Was it my best day with Kilkenny? Probably not, I'd say, because maybe it was, but it was a game I suppose probably won't forget. There has been great games played. I remember playing Leinster final against Offaly the following year, in 83. I got a goal against Offaly, and I didn't even see the. I was knocked floored by Damien Martin, and he rightly so. He came off the line, I got a pass in, and I hit it first time. But I thought that was one of my better games against Offaly that day. But you know, that Kilkenny team, the players up and down the field, they work so hard for each other. But it was great memories. Of course, Mihalo here makes, he's something special, you know. The description of the games are fabulous. And I think that 83 was the last game, if I'm right. I'm not sure that now. Possibly his last game.
Right. So, Richie, speaking of Mihalo here in commentary, I mean, his commentary in the last few minutes of the football final have gone down in legend entirely. Just give us an idea of the week, maybe, or the few days leading up to that final from an Offaly point of view. What were you thinking and what were you targeting?
we weren't very happy that the papers were, you know, all the commentators and whatever were so much in going for Kerry, you know, that suit is in. The Five in a Row song had come out. I think that was released maybe the Friday before the All-Ireland. There were scarves, Five in a Row scarves and t-shirts and all this sort of thing. So, like, we were delighted to see all that happen. Now, as regards having, we're still very aware that if we slipped at all, that, you know, that Kerry could really go to town. I mean, I think in the semi-final against Armagh, all the Kerry full forward line scored a goal, or each of the Kerry full forward line scored a goal, you know, that's sort of awesome potential. And I think there was talking about the Sunday game there a while back, but there was a guy, Dave Weldrick, I think the poor man died last year. He was one of the first analysts that did replays and so on. And after the Offaly Galway semi-final, the Sunday game, as far as I remember, he would have gone through the game and showed a number of mistakes. Then he referred back to the Kerry Armagh semi-final and showed what Kerry would have done in the same situation. And his summing up of after the Offaly Galway match was that the pick of Offaly and Galway wouldn't keep it kicked out to Kerry, which was
interesting.
Which was great.
All
things like that. But we were cuffed into a pint. But realizing too that if we slipped up at all, that Kerry would push to the sword. But there was an air of confidence. There was, you know, we had convinced ourselves that we had to be improving, and we had convinced ourselves too that Kerry had to be going back a bit. You know, they couldn't just stay at the top forever. And so our frame of mind, was very good.
You know, all right. Well, let's take a look at it. And of course, one of the most legendary games of all time. Clé Cánaiste na hÉireann 88-2, Kerry agus Offaly.
Collins with it and carrying it. Still Liam Collins. A shot that's high, and this one is over the bar. The first score of the game. The ball goes to Matt Connor. Connor a dummy. Still a dummy. And another dummy. He's shot and it's over the bar. What a lovely piece of play there by Matt Connor. His second point of the game. Liam Collins. Out to the wing now, And Brendan Lowry's shot is high and it's over the bar. A point there from out in the corner there. Jack O'Shea judging that one to a nicety. And the forwards trying to really get moving as Mikey Sheehy comes across from the far side in now to Owen Liston. Liston has shot the tie and Liston has shot that's good. His first score of the game. And that's how Owen Liston picks them these days. And Bomber Liston gets it and he takes his shot and sends it over the bar from an awkward enough angle to score. At this stage, 12 points for Kerry, 11 for Offaly. Martin Furlong in the goal. He saved it. He saved it. And he's got it out to Pat Fitzgerald. Oh, Martin, what a save. By Pádraig Dunn. Up to the wing to Owen Liston. Liston with the ball. A ground one into Joe. Oh, lovely kick back now to Pádraig. Pádraig over the bar. And there's the insurance once again. As Pádraig O'Shea, right half back, scores his second point of the game. It looks as if they were winning the way the Offaly men are just diddling and dawdling there. And here they come. This is Liam Connor, the fullback. A high, lobbing, dropping ball in towards the goal. A shot. A goal! A goal! A goal for Offaly. There was a goal in the game. A goal. Oh, what a goal. And Offaly lead in the dying moments. Here it is. Here it is again. And the ball is buried into the back of the net by the sub. And it's over. Offaly are champions. Oh dear. What a game. What a game. Oh, what excitement. That is one of the most sensational finals I have ever seen.
So, a sensational final.
How do you feel now compared to 71 and 72?
What did I say? I'm in heaven, man. I'm in heaven.
What about that penalty save?
How about?
Were you very anxious sitting on the sideline there?
I was. I was nearly desperate, actually. It's harder sitting on the line, you know. And I went in, I think, with about 10 minutes to go, and there were 4 pints down, if I can remember. And I had my mind fully bent that if I got a chance, I was going for a goal. Thanks for the goals.
First of all, I would like to congratulate you, Offaly. You gave a wonderful display today. As good as we have had, I think, since 1977. It was one of the best football finals I think we have had in the last 20 years. The game really needed that. And I'm delighted that it was Offaly that defeated us when we were to be beaten. You gave us a great game in last year's final. We had an outstanding semi-final 2 years ago. We got the breaks last year. I think you got a few breaks this time, and I think that's what made the difference. However, I would like to congratulate your team trainer, Eugene McGee. I think he's the one man that must be congratulated above all others. Congratulations, Eugene. Keep up the good work. We'll be back again next year to meet you in the final.
Eugene, if you can say anything, what can you say at this moment?
5 years of hard effort came to fruition there today, and I'm glad. For some players, I'm extremely glad, I can tell you. The two oldest players on the field, I think, Martin Furlong and Seamus Darby, won the match for us in their own different ways, and I'm delighted for them. I'm also delighted for every young player in Offaly that had faith in me and stood by me when times were very weak in the last 2 years.
Yes, Eugene McGee, sadly no longer with us, Richie, of course, but it was, he referenced Seamus Darby's goal, but I mean, Martin Furlong's penalty save has been talked about often as well. That really, had that gone in, would the game have been different? Would the result have been different, do you think?
Oh, of course, it would, yeah, it was vital. But we do slag Martin that he set up the penalty himself. He passed the ball out to, was it Mikey Sheehy or whatever. Mm. But Martin Furlong is a great character, you know, and again, a man of few words in the dressing room, but when he ever spoke, like there would, you'd hear a pin drop. He was just one of those characters, lovely fella and a great warrior. And of course, oh, if that goal had to go in, I think it would have been curtains, absolutely, yeah.
I know from your own point of view, you had great family connections with in that team, yourself and your brother Matt, your cousins Tomás and Liam. It was that kind of bonding, and there were other family members, of course, the Darbys and more involved in it. That the fact that you were drawing from a small community and a small population and people who knew each other and knew they'd have to face each other the following day. Was that an extra element in Offaly's success that year?
It probably was. You know, like if you take the area, the geographical area of football in Offaly, you know, Offaly is a sort of a split county as regards hurling down to south around Burren, Banagher and south of Tullamore mainly, and football is just on the north side going across, and the football area would be way less, I'd say, in geographical area than the Dingle Peninsula. So we all know one another so well, you know, and club football at the time was, there was huge rivalry. And but then, you know, we were able to go on the field together as a team. It was great. You know, there was a great bond between the team. And possibly, like, you know, there are three Lowrys, four Connors, as it turns out. Like, that's more or less half the team between two families, more or less. And then the two Fitzgeralds, Derbys, and so on. Yeah, and like, the Fitzgeralds would have only lived a mile down the road from us. We would have fought turf and the bog together. They would have played in our field, played football, but just the parish boundary between Gracefield and our parish, well, there was a bit of a drain. And, you know, so they played with Gracefield. But, you know, the so close. And I remember there was a collector. It was on the bog. And as teenagers, there would have been six of that team would have been on the collectors, where you threw turf into a machine and it made a pile of it or whatever. There were six off the team and the one collector one there. So it just shows you know, how close the whole thing was.
Yeah, Mac, a fechanter an Irinshin, you know, nor being to a kind fe imrori a honig and nias agus a vi mar imrori inspiroid draha Richie Matt. Be she just a mulle shane nach rev. I mean, be an timpish trigoida hige in the hior couple blin these DNE fehekar blin the dish. I guess say a creechnahem mar fellador. I guess sail aharaha gaham lawn. But nor echen to wear shoed marim roar. Cad he happened to?
Ah, then I'm going to toss it far. The girls are the flesher agam. I call real. Dochrete or fad. Nidjog okwo cliffe lechanish na heren. Kiri caracuidjog. Matt Connor Doni avoile carriage. For Matt Doheny, it was for Gerry Carroll Doheny, but the score in the first August on Skilvige August Tragod not Russia, ach terribly is fair nor wool and timpish day August then I'm going to toss it's fair Marderum or pleasure I'm echoing kicking a sear on the Emirates August nach Brown or there go Wusha Krivna here the fact that Tunis move back on.
We spoke about Matt, your brother, whose career and life utterly changed, of course, tragically in 84 with the car accident. That and other, I'm sure, influences impacted on the team because that was the highlight, wasn't it? 82 was the highlight. And from then on, I suppose, Offaly have tapered off, especially in more recent times. One Leinster title, I think, is all that has been won in 97 since then. So, reflections on that period and where Offaly football is now and how the wheel might turn again or can it turn again for Offaly?
You'd like to think it can, you know, but there's such a chasm now. There's a huge, like Dublin have gone so far ahead of the posse that for Offaly to be in contention, they would need, you know, 5 or 6 years of really, really knocking at the door and making some sort of progress in league and championship and to get a team together. You know, they're so far off winning the Leinster at the minute. And it's very difficult for players because, I mean, when you come out to the Offaly team back in the 70s, 80s, you expected to be in contention for Leinster titles, whether you're going to win one or not. You definitely felt. But I think present Offaly players probably don't feel that they're going to win the Leinster title. They just, you know, there's the inner belief is gone. And it'll take a lot of, you know, hard luck stories before that type of an obstacle is overcome, you know. So we didn't have to fight that obstacle. It was just, we're so used to it. When I was a teenager, I was going up to Croke Park looking at the 71, 72 team. My brother Mort would have been playing. My first cousin, Willie Bryan, would have been very involved. And, you know, you just felt, right, if I can get in there, I might be able to play in Croke Park as well and contest Leinster finals. But like the present team, you know, as far as they're concerned, I'm sure we're dinosaurs, you know, that's something that happened in prehistoric times. And so, you know, it's a huge mountain to have to climb at the minute.
All right, can I ask you finally, just before we leave you, on Matt, how is he? And
I mean, he would be obviously cocooned, and he would be vulnerable in the present climate. And even like a lot of us were on the footpath for Paddy Fenning's funeral there a couple weeks ago. And, but Matt wouldn't be even able to come out to that now. He just couldn't take the chance. He's vulnerable, but he's in great form. More than anybody, I'd say he's looking forward to the games getting back. He would be a huge man to go to all sorts of games, college games, minor games, whatever, under 16 leagues. He goes to matches all over the place.
All right. Okay. Good morning, Richie. Christy, final thoughts from you. The Kilkenny, you know, it's now 2015 was the last All-Ireland, and I suppose things have changed slightly. Do you see, with whatever kind of abridged championship lies ahead this winter, do you see Kilkenny being in the mix?
Hard to tell. I suppose we're in the final last year. You called it by default with a, you know, that sideline ball that was a 70 against Limerick and wasn't given. And there was a great fight in that team. That, you know, I think Kilkenny are the underdogs more so. They're more dangerous, and the underdogs are more dangerous. So I wouldn't give up on them. There's a few players come back with freshness, but then there's a few players that are gone a bit stale as well. So, and we don't have, unfortunately, we don't have the younger lads coming along like we used to have. So that's the backbone of any county, to have the younger lads coming along. And they don't seem to be there like they used to be. But hard to tell. I think Waterford, Wexford and Clare, they were flying the crest of a wave before we had this lockdown. I think Wexford and Clare, Waterford, there's a whole new energy with him, with Liam Cahill. Hard to know what way the championship was going to go. Tipperary now, of course, after having a rebuild, but you know, having that freshness was gone, and now they'd probably come back fresher. It's very open. It's great. I mean, the games are fantastic.
Yeah, I guess
I'm looking forward to it.
I'm sure, as we all are. Mac ni fadhuing anish gamekle here ashagring, shachtin bresha took egan realtas doing so. Hamid Galair etnu gamor la coursey sport to fill it.
Are we doing? Yeah. By different reached either the saharnogs the dona agus lehen to elun shachtina bishid. Galair fitu footil in a chéile chun fatamalacha. Yeah, is dolem tasha tukachun keen kaikish agan realtas ach. Shidam gamader gavan ha boardin kunda bedu gadohur shid ni clippy ray shacht kun keen shacht in vaan. So gavekamud action on jar shacht and kahara fikir gavi ul. So nilin chen ach shidam kuik hachtan on jar shacht and shahogan agus bring it on mardor to irahor utaran tukto ravan.
All right, Sinead Richie, yes, finally.
I'll ask Christy a question. The 82 Leinster hurling final, Matt Root got a goal.
I
want to ask you, was the ball far over the end line when Liam Fenley hit across?
It doesn't matter at this stage. The umpire couldn't see it, so that's all that matters anyway.
Well, it matters is what goes up on the scoreboard.
Listen, yeah, an empty goal. It hit into an empty goal. Damien Martin was looking at it going wide and over the line, and next thing, back into the net, and nobody there.
It might be 38 years, but the controversy continues. Cacular, Richie Connor, Christy Heffernan, MacDara McDonough, Gurmila Magav, Asfelling, and so Aaron Badcrail, Show. Dolan Scale, now Denigi Daru, Tranuna de Downig, Fehekon Eche, GAA Gold, and Scaler Fad, the Folletiot, Coursey Sport, the Gaskalorella, Atafta TG Carr, Agus Bamidna Arash, Asha Badcrail, and Derry Shachton, the Shahuing, a Fehekondraig, Nuinhedin Shahuing, Bekarta Marah, a Fehekondra Nadeg, Ochto Tree. All right, doing our Fad, Gadishan, Slonga Foy.